Solving polynomials is a hard problem. The usual approach you learned in school was probably to graph it, for example, x squared minus x minus 1. The trouble is that the more points you graph, the more computation you have to do. And it's also not the most accurate. For example, this has roots at 1 plus the square root of 5 over 2, these values, and finding that on a graph is difficult. Also, what if you graph the wrong area? And what if your roots are complex numbers? To solve an equation like this directly, the first thing you do is divide the leading coefficient, a, giving you this form, and then move that c over a term to the right side. If we only had one root, we could write our equation as the quantity x plus k squared. When expanded, it would be x squared plus 2kx plus k squared. If we let 2k be b over a, that gives us k as b over 2a, and k squared is b squared over 4a squared. This means if we want our equation to be of that form, we need to add a k squared term of b squared over 4a squared to both sides. That lets us then write our equation in this form with the quantity x plus b over 2a squared, giving our right side equation. This looks more complicated, but actually helps us. The next thing we'll do is normalize our fractions on the right side. Then we can simplify our fraction and take the square root of both sides, giving us this form. Moving our b over 2a term to the right side and simplifying it gives us the quadratic equation. The trouble with solving it directly is that this equation only works for polynomials of degree 2. There's another form for cubics and another for quartics, but there isn't an equation to solve directly polynomials of degree 5 or higher. For that, we need to solve them numerically. To solve things numerically, the normal process is to start with one or more guesses and then apply an iteration function such as Newton's method. Given our starting value of 1, we can apply 3 iterations of Newton's method to converge relatively quickly. This is super fast and super accurate. There are many root finding methods out there, such as secant method and Muller's method, even polynomial specific ones like Aberth-Ehrlich, except most of these have issues when it comes to multiplicity of roots, as well as requiring good initial starting values. All the ones I just listed, though, also aren't guaranteed to converge. One that is, though, is bisection, using the intermediate value theorem. When a continuous function changes sign, such as going from negative to positive or positive to negative, that means it has to cross the zero mark, like our earlier example. Starting guesses for our interval a and b, we compute the midpoint c, and then check the function signs at each of those points. We'll keep the interval that contains our sign change. We compute a new midpoint c and restart the process. If an interval contains a root, bisection will find that root. The only trouble then becomes, how do you find a good starting interval? And then, what if your roots are complex? We can plot complex numbers on the complex plane with the horizontal bar representing real numbers and the vertical one being imaginary, such as the value of 1/2 plus I. Here is a heat map showing the modulus of the function z to the 8th plus 15z to the 4th minus 16, where the darker spots are the roots. This equation has 8 roots, but only 2 of them are real. Is there a way to test if an area contains a root? And is there a way to narrow this area? This leads into the main subject of today's video, the Lehmer-Schur algorithm. It is composed of 2 parts, a circle test and an analyst search. We'll just start by assuming that there is a test and that it works, focusing more on the analysts. Our first task, find a ring that contains the root. But one thing to note is that 0 should not be a root, because if you had a polynomial and you plugged in 0, that would mean the constant term was 0 if 0 was a root. Simply deflate if that's the case. Otherwise, start with a radius of 1 and stop once you find an analyst. Each time you do a test with this radius, if it passes, you'll divide the radius by 2, and if it fails, you'll multiply by 2 and restart. Let's then start to find that ring by starting with the unit circle, radius of 1, and test it with the circle test. Hypothetically, let's say this test passed. We'll then fill our border of our circle with a solid line. Then divide our radius by 2 and do another test. This one, let's just say, also passed. That means our circle will have a solid line around the outside. Another half, giving us a radius of a fourth. And testing this circle, let's say it failed. That means we now can stop because we found an annulus. This shaded area here contains a root. Let's try another scenario. In this case, we again start with the unit circle, and when we run test circle, this failed the test. That means we can draw our circle with a dashed line. Afterwards, double our radius to come up with a new circle to test. This time it also failed. Draw with a dashed line and double the radius to this time 4. Run test circle, and hypothetically, let's say this one passes. We'll then draw it with a solid line, and we can stop. We found a ring that contains our root. In both cases, we start with the unit circle. When it keeps passing, we keep halving the radius and trying again until it fails. When it keeps failing, we double the radius and try again until it passes. Once we found a ring that contains a root, we then cover that annulus with circles. Lehmer used 8 evenly spaced circles of radii r times 5/6 at this equation for their centers. And then restart our search on the circle that passed the test. You can stop searching once you found a circle that passes the test. In this case, we didn't need to do those last two tests. The other thing to consider is that you can actually stop testing after you have 7 failed tests, because the 8th circle must contain the root. You also should avoid searching part of the ring that you've already searched for, using this scheme of tests. This approach tries to test areas that you haven't already covered in prior tests until you get about halfway through. Keep in mind that after the 7th, you don't need to test the 8th. You would know if the 7th one failed, the 8th one must contain a root. Lehmer actually published this method in 2 papers, the second of which includes a different equation for his circles that's slightly more efficient, but it doesn't matter too much. Let's take a look at his illustrated example. Starting from the unit circle, it failed, expand outwards, it failed, expand outwards, it passed. We can search this ring. 2 tests later, it found a circle that passes. Look for a ring, and we have that. Start searching this ring. 1, 2, 3, this 3rd test passed. Look inside the circle. This test failed, which means we have a ring. And then 5 tests later, this circle contains our root. I visualized this in Python, writing some code that I'll share on the GitHub repository for this channel. Link will be in the video description, but you can run this yourself on any polynomial and try this circle technique to see how it visualizes it. It doesn't take very many iterations until you find a circle with a small enough radius to where you can stop the search because you found your root. There are some quirks to this method though. It can find a root that is outside of your ring. I've illustrated it with this example. It can also tend to find smaller roots, such as this example, but it can't find the smallest root, or I should say it's not guaranteed to find the smallest root because it doesn't know where the roots are in the ring. You can also try to modify this approach to test 8 rings at once. Note though that there may be some overlap. Now it's time to go back and look at that circle test, which we skipped earlier. This test transforms polynomials around circles and any arbitrary circle to the unit circle. Essentially, plug in your radius and your center into your polynomial to come up with a new polynomial called g, with coefficients a sub 0, a sub 1, etc. Then, find an associated polynomial called g star, which has all the coefficients reversed and in complex conjugate. We then create a mapping function called t, given by this equation. If t of g of 0 is negative, that means our transformed circle has a root, and so does the original. If it was 0, we can stop. We did not find a root. And if it's positive, that means we try computing t of g, and repeat the process until you get 0 or a negative number. Let's try to synthesize by looking at some examples. With our polynomial equation of z squared minus z plus 1/2, we plug that into our equation for g. Because we're using the radius of 1 and our center of 0, it's not going to change anything. G will just be our starting polynomial. G star is all of our coefficients reversed and in complex conjugate, which looks like this. Then we compute our t equation, plugging everything in, giving a value of 0 over 2 minus 3 over 4. Plugging in 0, we get a negative number. This means it passed the test. With our new polynomial of z squared minus 2z plus 2, plug in our radius of 1 and center of 0 to come up with our equation for g, which is the exact same function. Then, computing g star, reversing the coefficients and a complex conjugate, giving our equation for t of minus 2z plus 3. Plugging in 0 gives us a positive value, which means it fails the test. Redo with the new value for t, find t of g is z, giving just 5 as our equation. Plugging in 0 gives us still back 5, being a positive value, meaning it failed. Try again with t of g. This gives us 0 and stop. It never passed any of the test. It means it does not contain a root. To sort of recap, our g equation is a transformation to the uncircle, requiring a radius and a center. G star is technically the conjugate reciprocal polynomial, meaning all of its new roots are inverses and complex conjugates of g. Our t function is a mapping that uses the roots of g and g star. Recall that a star means it's the product of all the roots of g, the constant term. The leading coefficient, a sub n, would normally be 1, but it's been scaled by the radius. This means t is essentially measuring the root imbalance between g and g star. Plugging in 0 cancels a lot of terms, basically giving us a difference between a0 and a sub n. When that is negative, the product of all the roots are smaller than the radius. This means at least one root is inside the radius. When it's positive, it means we don't know. One of the roots might be too large, and it's messing up the product. This means we simply just try t again. For a full proof, I recommend checking out Lehmer's paper. Link will be in the description. This method will converge on a root, and odds are that root will be complex. It will do so with a linear order, though. So, it might be a good idea to try a few iterations of this approach, and then switching to something that is higher order, like Knud's method. What about a hybrid approach? For example, if you notice that your iterations in Knud's method are going outside of the circle that you know has the root, switch to Lehmer-Schur. Also, if the iterations function is taking a very long time to converge, you might also think about applying the techniques from the Knud-Safe algorithm. The algorithm can also help bisection. First, find an analyst that contains your root, then check the left and right number lines with circles. Keep whichever one passes the interval. Note though that this might be passing because of a complex root, so it's best to use if you know that all roots are real. To recap, root finding is a hard problem, and there are many solution techniques out there to try and solve it. Regular root finding methods aren't guaranteed to converge, even though methods like bisection are, except it's not guaranteed for complex numbers. The Lehmer-Schur algorithm uses an analyst search in the complex plane along with a circle test. It's guaranteed to find a root and can test up to 7 circles, with the 8th one passing if the 7th one failed. It tends to find smaller roots, and remember that it starts with a radius of 1 with the unit circle. That circle test we talked about works on any radius and any center, and Lehmer-Schur can be used to find a starting point for other methods like Knud's method. You could also make a full-blown hybrid algorithm like Knud-Safe, but for the complex plane, using Lehmer-Schur. As always, thank you for watching. Let me know what you thought about this algorithm in the comments below. And don't forget to check out the links in the description for the code that I used in this video.